eventual
aren't miniaturized electronics fabulous?
It's incredible.
Like 20 years ago.
Yeah, this would have been so much more.
Oh, absolutely. Yeah. I had a three-chip Sony. That had a three-chip Sony. You know, it's about this. And I had a one-chip, first generation. And this is a piece of stuff.
I remember when having like a three-chip camera was like the thing.
Oh, yeah, absolutely.
Yeah.
How's this framing?
And now they have the GoPros, which are little hi-fi little box.
And
I did a drive around with my big Imperial out there. And they just stuck one on the side of the car, and you have this in motion, the reflections going by, and stick it on the windshield coming into the through the windshield.
So I guess eyeline is going to be like directly to me.
Okay.
So I'll try to remain.
So it's slightly
here.
Off. Yeah.
Yeah, it's slightly off.
I don't want to do this.
You'd be surprised how many people you say like eyeline's over here, and they look directly at the camera.
Yeah.
Like you know, it's just.
Or you know, if you want to really.
Depends on how often they.
Want to really
the camera,
freak someone out when you're talking to them. Look at their forehead just about, and they'll pick this up, right? And it's kind of freaky, like a robot that they haven't tuned right.
Mm-hmm.
Can you tell now if I'm looking at your ear rather than right at you?
No.
Yeah, you're too far away. But if you're up close, you look at somebody's ear
or
up at the top of their forehead and think, what's going on?
Looking good.
Okay. So, yeah, so I'll just start right.
Okay.
So I'm just going to start with, do futurists influence the future, or have they influenced the future?
Futurists definitely influence the future, because what they're doing is inventing what the future could look like in a series of specific instances. And if you're in public media, that absolutely influences what people expect, and what people expect becomes pretty much real, because you have this whole commercial base to make what they think is real come true, and then they can pay for it. It's really kind of nasty economics, but that's the way it works. And movies and public media and press that cover futuristic things, absolutely, it influences.
Is there then a responsibility of the futurist when designing a scene or scenario like that?
I don't know. I don't. The word responsibility bothers me. I would say inspire, rather. Because influencing is the side effect of inspiring, and I think it's a better way to think about it.
So
influencing sounds too despotic to me.
So then is there, I guess, a role to inspire? Is that the role of the futurist?
Yes.
Inspire?
Yeah. That's why my view of the future, and I've worked for some, well, here's the example. Somebody says, Mr. Mead, why do you think the future is going to be so crappy? When you worked on Blade Runner. Well, of course, that was 30 years ago. And I said, it was a professional job. Ridley wanted to make a noir science fiction film, so I helped him do that visually. I said, I think that we should celebrate and rehearse for a bright future, and maybe it'll come true just like that. I don't know. But I don't have time to illustrate misery or dystopian scenarios, because they'll happen. If you let everything go, they'll happen anyway. Unfortunately.
Sorry, give me one second. Okay, so this has to do with a little bit of what you were saying. So some of your pieces can be described as like fantasy, while others feel very, very probable. Are you thinking of that as you work, or does the image come to you like fully realized?
Well, the image happens because what you're doing is, whether it's a movie script or I'm doing it for a magazine illustration or for a client just as commercial art, which I did a lot of that, what you're doing is illustrating a world that looks like that, maybe a snapshot. So you've got to be there in your head. You've got to be in that world. Think of it rationally so that you create a visual picture of something in that world that looks that way for that reason. And if it's consistent, then people will like it much better than if it's discordant. And a lot of my argument with a lot of futurists, I hate the word, but it's operational, is that they skip the logic of why they're doing what they're doing and it doesn't look like it fits. Now, sometimes the story is that it doesn't fit. You know, something is out of place in time. But if you're doing a straight future vision of something, it has to be consistent with why it looks that way in that world. It's very philosophical in a strange way.
That's one of the more interesting things to me, is that it is philosophical, because obviously, like, your base is the world around you, and then, you know, wherever you go from there, in some ways you have to start with where you are.
Mm-hmm.
And in that way that, you know, if you're doing work in the 1950s, it's somehow always reflective of the 1950s,
yes,
and the same for the 1980s,
yep,
and the same, you know, so it's really a reflection of
That's why we have Google. I used to, we're cleaning out our office, and before Google, I used to have drawers full of reference for rendering and illustration, for style of a costume and all that. Now you Google, I'm doing something maybe in 1970, 80, and you Google costumes for men and women 1980. Well, there it is. You know, it's got a boom.
It's so instant. You know,
and doing costumes for the future, there was a stereotypical future where all the costumes had epaulettes or big things over the shoulders, you know, sort of Flash Gordon. And it was iconic, and now it looks really stupid. But at the time, that was a science fiction kind of a iconic thing to do. Now, you might have costumes that are retro, and they're driving around in these big shiny vehicles, and they're wearing, the women are hoop skirts, and the men have tuxedos, I don't know. But you can play with that variance as the visual gimmick, and fashion is a gimmick anyway, so you can play with it that way.
Yeah, that reminded me of, like, in Gattaca, that's a little bit like that.
Yeah.
Where it's like this retro, but it is a future, and mm-hmm, then they kind of use architecture as a base to build off of that.
And now you're getting the Teddy Boy. I think Justin Bieber showed up one of the award shows with his jacket with a gold dragon over the fabric, which is sort of a teddy boy gone Chinese, gone future, gone crazy. And it looked rather elegant. Of course, he's young and thin, too, you know, so.
Going back to the thing of, like, the 50s and working from the 50s and that, when you were working specifically for U.S. Steel, like, those specific illustrations, like, were you told, like, specific things to execute? Like, I know, like, within that folder there was the that timeline of probabilities.
Yes.
Do you know who came up with that? Like, was that something that you did? Or
I think the probabilities was created by a writer. What I did for that U.S. Steel series, now this is going back into the 60s, what I did was run in my head a timeline of, we still had four wheels because it was for car companies. In fact, I did a couple of illustrations with these wonderful floating things, and the advertising agency in Pittsburgh said, we can't have it in the book because there's no wheels. I said, okay, so I can accommodate that. But what I was doing was saying, cars are a sort of a rolling eagle structure announcement. And back then, cars were 20 feet long, 18 feet long, luxury cars. I also did some city cars, very small ones. But what I was doing was synthesizing a future where cars looked like this, and it was commercial, so it was for U.S. Steel. They had steel trim, they were made from steel and so forth. So I was synthesizing a whole technological, stylistic put together that was attractive to people that were in the business of designing cars for the future. And now when you work on a movie, then the script is the Bible, and it says now everything can fly. We have anti-gravity. We have this, 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 this. And then you design for that world to make it consistent. That's why in the original Blade Runner, you had flying cars, and I designed all those vehicles. And my idea then was the cars, the vehicles are characters in the film. They shouldn't change. That's why it had no propellers, no wings came out on the spinner. It was what they call an aerodyne, which is an internal propulsion lifting system. So nothing changed, really. The wheels rotated, but that's all.
So one of the similarities between you and Radovan, that you both served in the armed services and then worked for car companies.
Yes.
If you could talk a little bit about, like, that experience and what that time was like.
Well, I started this. The reason I got into the car business is because I'd always been fascinated with cars since a little kid. I started drawing when I was three, four years old, people in cars waving out the windows. So I've been drawing for a long time. And I drew some cars when I was in the Army in Okinawa, sent some pictures to John Reinhardt, who was then head of Ford Styling. And he sent back saying, there's a school in Los Angeles you should go to. So that's why I went to Art Center. And then I trained as an industrial designer, maybe not specifically cars, but with that accent. And then I got a position at Ford's Advanced Studio as my first job out of Art Center. And, you know, found out about corporate design on a team basis and worked on the advanced show cars and things like that. And then I left Ford for a much better salary deal. Then I could design cars theoretically with my industrial design background, so they became logical. They looked like they could actually be built that way. And they weren't just slick shapes rolling down. They had seams on the body design. They had placement of things. And they looked real. And then I would put these into a scenario that was attractive and fun or colorful, imaginative. And the comment that I get all the time is that people look at my renderings and they say, I'd like to live there. I'd like to be there. So that's a compliment. It's a compliment to the consistency of creating a world, making a picture of it like a snapshot, and being left alone to do that.
You talked a little bit about this before, but that for both you and Radabaugh, you both have a very like optimistic view of the future. And where does that stem from? If we could just have that as like an individual.
Well, the future is a composite of everybody, what everybody's doing, what they want to do, what they actually can do, and the will to do it, you know, as a society. And so the future is all of us going together somewhere where we don't really know. And you'd like to sort of try to arrange it so when you get there, it's nice to be there. Other than some, you know, turn to a total cesspool of trouble and worry. And so I try to create a glossy, I've been accused of doing, you know, create a glossy chrome-plated future, which if you get to these, go to these societies that have a dim view of everything, and they accuse me of being of sort of stealing their lowered expectations.
Within all of your scenarios, like do they all take place in the same world, or are they like different worlds? Like, is there?
Well, if they're taking place in my world, you can invent your own world, and when you're doing a job for a commercial client that wants you to create a future look at, for whatever reason, then you invent with this tailored look that fits their agency. Sounds sort of well, it is. It's a business, and so I create my scenario, and illustrate why it would be that way, and go ahead and make it all up. But with an industrial design background, I can make it all up, and it looks like it really should be that way.
Because that's another interesting similarity between like you and Radabaugh, that Radabaugh would take something like some of his later Close and Then We Thinks are very specific and will tell you like, you know, these kinds of propellers, this kind of
yeah.
Things, so that it does fit. So when you see, you know, I don't know, somebody floating in space,
right.
Also, it all fits in that world.
Yeah.
So that there
yeah.
are a lot of technical details
mm-hmm.
That you're able to put in there.
Yeah, it has to be technically a movie script or a movie story or it's a press magazine article or whatever. It has sort of an insinuation of why the world is that way for that story. And that's very critical. You and I have both seen movies that the technology defaults for the convenience of the story. And then you've ruined the whole thing. I think the success stylistically of the original Blade Runner that Ridley put together is that it is consistent all the way through, pretty much, and it's a world all to itself. I mean, it's there. And you go into it, you watch it, and nothing disturbs the continuity or the rationality of the story.
Let me go through a few of these. Yeah, I guess if we could have you talk like a little bit about like what you remember of that time of the atomic age, of like what that was like, even just around you as a designer, societally.
Well,
you know,
the '50s. You know, this is after World War II. Now we had the Korean War and all. I was involved in that. I was in the army, but that was a very exciting. It was exciting technologically. It was exciting socially. It was an exuberant expectation that the future was going to come true, like all these drawings were showing people. We were going to ride around in self-driving cars. Now it's coming true. We were going to ride around in cars that were sort of big glass canopy teardrops and things. And the exuberance of the technological expectation was really quite wonderful. And you responded to that. Now, a dystopian, everything blows up every 5 minutes. I guess that's the Bruckheimer formula. And it bothers me because maybe it's a cathartic. I don't know. If it's bad things are happening and thank God I'm not involved in it, that makes you feel better and you can enjoy life. I don't know if that's what it is or not. But the preponderance of science fiction movies are everything blows up eventually. And it's much harder to make a picture that's good stuff happening than bad stuff happening. So maybe it's just a lack of marketing. I mean, you are making a movie as a business. It's not a missionary effort. And so you go with what the demographic expects to see. And the attention span and all these things dial into that. And people that make movies that make money know that, and they're making money. It's not a biblical, you know, religious thing or missionary effort. It's business. And it's a rather surprising, nerve-wracking business, too.
It's funny, like, when you look at a movie like Destination Moon or something.
Yes.
There's almost no conflict in that movie.
No.
You know what I mean? Like, they get to the moon. You know.
The conflict is actually doing what the movie is about, rather than everybody in the crew hates each other, and then they have this this entity that's somehow going to destroy them all, and they can't agree on how to get rid of it. You know, this is conflict, or the thing's going to blow up, and they got to figure out which is the blue wire or the red wire that you cut first. You know, that sort of thing. But you're right. Destination Moon was just the exuberance of this whole moon thing, and that was the story. Just doing it was the story.
But later on, like as you know, society moves into like the space age. Like, was it different in tone? Did it change?
Yes. Yeah. 2001, Kubrick's film. I called that the GE Kitchen of Tomorrow look. Everything is pristine white, and it was nice and clever. Then you come along, and I worked on 2010 with Peter Himes at MGM, and the Russian ship, the Leonov, that I designed. Now the public knew that you could move something through space at light speed, and it was shaped like a box. You know, you didn't have to have all this stuff. And so it looked very mechanical. Even 2001, the spaceship with the big ball in front and the long structural thing with the antenna, it was sort of more mechanical than the early rocket to the moon look. Because the rocket to the moon, the public didn't know yet that you didn't need a needle nose to go through empty space. You know, you can fly a box. So that changed a lot. And that's the big, when I got around to doing 2010, then we knew that. We could have this structural, sort of clumsy looking piece of stuff going up to rescue the Discovery.
So after Closer Than We Think kind of finished its run, or like near the end of it, the Jetsons premiered.
Yes.
And like the Jetsons is very like clearly inspired by a lot of different Closer Than We Thinks. Like you can put them side by side and they're almost the same. I know that you did some work for a live action Jetsons movie.
Yes, I did. Warner Brothers canceled it.
Did you ever like look back like at the original Jetsons, like as you were coming up with that stuff? Like,
absolutely.
What
I mean,
did you think of it? Or?
Well, another, and again, that's public media. You can go back and load all this stuff up on YouTube. So absolutely, I looked at all that stuff, got printouts. And so I was going to create the vehicle and the scenario to the script. Rob, who is the Stuart Little Mouse Pictures?
Yeah, I'm trying to remember his last name. It's with an M.
Anyway, he came to the house here a couple of times. And I think maybe he thought that he was going to be stereotyped as doing animation live action combos, and maybe he didn't want that. I don't know, but for some reason, the whole thing was canceled. So, but it was going to be a live action computer animation dial-in movie from Warner Brothers. It was a lot of fun. I did a new Rosie, you know, the maid.
Yeah.
I had to design all this stuff, and definitely keyed to the original TV series.
Because I guess, yeah, that's one of the larger questions, too, is that, like, the Jetsons originally, debuted in 62 and was supposed to take place in 2062.
Mm-hmm.
It was then revived in 85 or 86, and yet still kind of was trying to take,
yeah,
you know, future keys from the 60s, but at the same time, you know, it's the 80s. So the Jetsons film that you worked on was around, what, 2000, around then?
About, yeah.
Around then?
Yeah.
Like, was it reflective of that time, or were you trying to, did it have a retro feel to it?
Well, what he was trying to bring off, I think, was that he's doing a Jetsons restrike. We had the vehicle. Now, the vehicle had to be a real prop, which meant it was round, because you could have this section slide. You had to have actors getting in and out of it. The dog was going to be added digitally, I think. And the scenery was going to be all digital, because you had these, you can't build a floating hamburger stand. Well, you could, but to the size of the green screen. And so I think what he was doing with the restrike of Jetsons 2, the movie, was to strike a balance between duplicating the exuberant style of the cartoon Jetsons as much as possible, because it was a cartoon. Now, he's having to do it in 3D live. And he accommodated the story and accommodated the style, but moving it over into something you can actually do in on camera with actors and props. And I thought it would have been fantastic. A lot of fun.
Yeah, I would have loved to have seen that. specifically with the space age, like, did design change once we went to the moon? Like, did something change there?
Well, you know, I tell people the future came true, but it came true in little bits and pieces called consumer goods. You know, we have a little miniaturized, I have a Apple Shuffle, which is the size of a postage stamp. I have a Nano, which is even smaller than that. They're both 4 gigabytes. That's astonishing. They have just successfully recorded, or it has the capacity to record, 386 gigabytes on a nano-tuned crystal. And the stability of the data is 14 billion years. So now we're at essentially unlimited memory. It's almost free. You can buy a 2-3 gigabyte, you know, side drive for a couple $100 or less. So the going to the moon thing was a crossover between what you could do with rather minimal computer assistance and just raw human courage. And it worked, obviously. We didn't leave anybody up there. And it was a crossover because we proved to ourselves we could do that. And then it accelerated from there. When the shuttle, one of the most amazing machines ever built by mankind, went into orbit with less computing power than an iPhone. And eventually they did all the telemetry down to Houston for the big computers to do the heavy lifting on computational orbits and all that sort of thing. But I think it was a crossover in terms of satisfied ambition that we could go ahead and do something that complicated. And it was incredibly complicated to do that. I have friends that work at JPL, and I was telling this fellow, I said, what's amazing to me, the Earth is rotating, we're going around the sun, so is Mars at a different rate. Mars is spinning on itself, and they could land something at a specific spot on Mars. And because it's 15 minutes away by light speed communication, it has to do it all by itself. You don't know what's happening in real time. And as we go further out into space, we are isolated by real time. We don't know what's happening at all until it's already happened, and maybe that's too late.
Yeah, like I remember that with the Curiosity rover.
Like, yes.
You just had these moments of, well, it happened, but we don't know what happened.
That's exactly right. Yeah. So we're trapped. We're in a time trap, unless we can figure out a way to, you know, abort the whole time limitation, which theoretically is the speed of light, but that's wrong. The speed of light is not the final universal limit.
What do you think is?
Doesn't matter.
Oh, okay.
Doesn't matter.
Throughout his career, like Radebaugh would return to some of the same subjects, kind of like repurposing them for different clients and comic strips. Like, have you done that? Like, where you are drawn to something over the years and you kind of bring it back a little bit and maybe change it for the time?
Well, professionally, I've redesigned the two Japanese iconic anime series, the Yamato, which is the battleship. I met Mr. Matsumoto and he approved my design. He designed the original transfer into the, then I redesigned all the Gundam characters, Gundam mobile suit. And that's the second iconic Japanese anime series. My liaison, Japanese liaison, hated Hello Kitty, so we don't even talk about that. I made a joke, she had a birthday. This is off, has completely off subject. And she had a birthday, and I did a Hello Kitty cake for her. So I cut out a stencil, and you can spray, you know, food dye through a mask and make a shape. Then you spray, airbrush it with food dye. And it was Hello Kitty, and she was just, she didn't know what to think. I said, it's for you, Miko. I mean, you know, hey. But I think repurposing something is, you have to deal with expectation. And if it's commercial, usually I work, I don't sit in a studio and glue neckties to stepladders. You know, that's not what I do, and call it art. And so if you're repurposing something, you have to keep your recognizability trigger. And then you can do a lot of stuff that's weird. But as long as you have a recognizability, something in the mix, the visual mix that people relate to, then it clicks, and they know sort of what it is. Then they appreciate the distance between familiarity and new. And that's really what I'm hired to do over and over and over.
I was going to say, this is, I guess, specific also to kind of like the 50s through the 70s, but like, what is the legacy of a commercial artist? Because like the work, you know, like a lot of Radebaugh's work, like as we've gone back and researched and stuff, was just discarded by the, you know, like it all went to the client and then was discarded.
Yep.
So like, what is that legacy?
Well, commercially, once the job's over, nobody cares. They're on to the next job. All the U.S. Steel art was going to be destroyed by the agency in Pittsburgh. It's a merchandising, advertising effort. Had nothing to do with keeping it or treasuring it or any of that. It was momentary. The books were printed. They were given out to the auto industry and vehicle designers all over the world. And once the job is over, then they don't care. The auto companies discard their show cars, usually. Now, GM keeps them all, but I don't think Ford does, or Chrysler. Some of them they do. But the honorific keeping of what's been done is not that really, not that common. The only reason Lucas keeps all of his sets and costumes and stuff is because he takes advantage of a tax break. And if you let the public see some of that every year at an exhibition or something, then you get, it goes back into his warehouse. Well, now Disney owns it all. And so it's a whole thing of how important is this and why, socially or technologically or as a media sort of museum review. And that's sort of a rare thing.
So then ultimately, like, are those artists forgotten?
Yeah. I was invited. I'm an honorary member or a member of the Illustrator Society. Leindecker and Maxfield Parrish and I think Rockwell was the first member. So I'm in good company as an illustrator, and they survived because their fellow artists admired what they did so much that they kept it all. Norman Rockwell, the Illustrators Club in New York, their building has a Rockwell, a Maxfield Parrish, I'm sorry, a mural up on above the bar. The bar's on the fourth floor, no elevator, so I don't go in there anymore. But it was kept because it was valuable professionally to the admirers that were in the same field. I think that's one reason, or the reason maybe that any of it was kept at all.
Yeah, because actually that is, specifically to Radebaugh, there was one person he worked with that kept, like, through
mm-hmm.
his originals,
yeah.
And he was like, I got these the day that they were throwing them away.
Yeah,
you know?
Exactly.
It's
John Reinhardt, who was the automotive marketing director for U.S. Steel when I did all those steel books, God, back in the 60s. He drove down, when he found out what they were going to do, he drove down to Pittsburgh and loaded his station wagon up with all this artwork that was on the way to the trash pile. Amazing. And I really didn't think anything about it because I was young. I could paint this stuff like wildfire. And I didn't think of it as a trust to keep it. I was doing new stuff. I was being paid for it. And it didn't bother me that I'd never see it again. Now it's nice. I'll get an email from somebody who has one of these. And I think, well, that's really cool. We don't know where the rest of them went to. I have no idea.
Was it 3 or 4 years ago, I bought a sealed U.S. steel book with like, you know, 6 or 7 in there.
Yes.
I opened it to frame a few.
Yeah.
But I don't know where it came from or anything. But yeah, like some.
Well,
eBay. Was keeping them.
eBay. Some of this stuff goes for hundreds and hundreds of dollars.
Yeah.
And when I tell people in those days working for the company in Chicago that printed all those, we would take those books and cut them up to make mailer dummies to show to the client. They said, no, you didn't. Yes, we did. We had lots of them. We had stacks of them.
Yeah, it's such beautiful work. I think I only have one other question. It's kind of a general thing, but like, as a society, like, why are we obsessed with the future? Like, you know, most popular films are science fiction in the future. You know, like,
yeah,
it's all around us all the time.
Well, because we're going there whether we want to or not. And uncertainty is a characteristic that human beings just don't like. We won't go into religion, but what we do is we like a response to the question, what's going to happen? What's going to happen to me? Where are we all going? Why? And it's a very, very human thing. Dogs and cats aren't Presbyterian because they don't know they're going to die. You know? That's my sort of simplistic explanation. But from time immemorial, the early man kept track of the stars and the rotation of the earth relative to the sun and the equinox and all that because they wanted predictability. And once you got to that stage, then you started to build things like the observatories in the Middle East at that time. You had Stonehenge and the Egyptians, and at equinox, this light would come down the shaft, ding, and light up the god's face or whatever. And that meant that, oh, well, we got through that again. And now we're ready to start another cycle. And that predictability is intrinsic to the human, the way we think, because we're intelligent and we have the ability to synthesize experience. And animals don't have that.
So that's what we're always looking.
Yes.
To, you know.
Yeah. And if you can synthesize a future that's interesting or exciting or even the cathartic effect, it's just part of the human psyche. Well, you're responding to how humans like to think.
All right, I'm just going to review this really quick, but I think that's actually it. Oh, you know what? I wanted to ask you about, all your work is signed very, like, distinctly.
Yes.
Was that common, like, when you were working for, like, U.S. Steel or something? Because, like, Rathbaugh has a very distinct signature as well.
Yes.
It makes it into advertising. Sometimes it gets a little cut off, like, they'll just frame it, however.
I thought of the signature at Art Center. We had to do a graphic version of our last name, Mead, in my case. And thank goodness I didn't have Schwarzenegger or Schlesinger or something. I don't know what I would have come up with. But I was reading about oscilloscopes. And the oscilloscope thing goes, on like that. But, well, that's an M. I'll just do 2 on. So that's how I thought up the signature, and I've used it ever since the middle 50s. And the name on the artwork, are we running out?
Yeah, the card is full. We just have to switch cards.
But I think putting your name on your artwork was pretty much standard procedure. And if you weren't allowed to do that, I mean, then you're just a grunge working for an advertising agency.
Mm-hmm.
And advertising agencies are almost always like overpopulated at the top.
So I guess if, I'm trying to remember exactly where we were when. Yeah.
It was about the name, primarily.
I guess I'm trying to remember exactly what we had on camera, of whether or not we got the of like how common was it or not in that time.
I think it was pretty common. You see Leyendecker stuff, you see Perich's stuff, and it's all signed.
Because it's specific. There's, I think, National Oil Seals. There was like a campaign that Radebaugh did with, and then there was another artist, and then it's like every piece that isn't signed is the other person, and then everything else is Radebaugh. So that's why I didn't know how.
Well, and sometimes they just use their initials. Remember the Pontiac series of ads? It was a Fitzpatrick, and his partner was AK. I'm trying to think what that was stood for. But they would sign, you see the letters down there at the bottom of the piece of art.
Well, I think that might be it. Yeah, I'm sorry, I thought I had to follow up for a second. Are you ever thinking of a statement with a scenario or the art?
Well, I'm not a writer. And no, I really don't think of a statement. What I'm doing to myself is sort of a statement because it's highly visible, and I've invented it for a specific reason. So that's sort of my signature style. I've had people recognize my style, and I don't necessarily know how to do that. We got a drawing from some fan and said, "Did you do this?" And I looked at it and I thought, I don't know if I did it or not. It's been 50, 60 years since. And then I saw my name way over in the side, and I said, yeah, I guess I did that. And I was trying a new style of brush background without too much detail, and then planting the intricately rendered thing over the top of that. And I don't do that anymore. And that's why I didn't recognize my own work, because at the time I was doing something different.
So for like the U.S. Steelwork, how there were like paragraphs next to it, yes, that would describe that. That was by like a writing team or something?
That was by the writing team, and they would commonly ask me, "What is that?" I'd explain, and that went into the text. And I've had, when I give presentations, and particularly in Japan, the language base is based on the traditional way of thinking, like a Japanese person. Now, the younger generation is more international. But I was giving a presentation at, I think it was Waseda, and my liaison said, they're asking how you create things. I said, well, you have to be three people. You have to be the person that gets the assignment, and you become a crazy scientist, and you draw really weird stuff, and then that's the number of the first person. The second person comes in and says, well, I like that better than that. So you're self-analyzing what you just did for suitability. Then the third person is sort of, you are the client representative kind of person, and that's where you nail it down, and that's it. And I said, I call this being carefully crazy. And she looked at me and she said, there's simply no way I can translate that, because it's so un-Japanese to think that way that you can translate carefully crazy. I was doing a nightclub in Tokyo, and it was a gambling club. And so I designed the whole thing, and I had, it was red with red light, and the lighting people said, you can't do that. I said, yes, you can, so we did. And what the aim was to have the guys bring their girlfriends and stay longer because they had their girlfriends with them. Well, the girlfriends maybe wouldn't know how to run a game table, whatever. So we were going to have facilitators that would go around and sort of, you know, how do you play, whatever. And so I had these people dress up. We had male and female. And I put them in red body stockings so you could attach the costume additions with Velcro. So you could take the body stocking off and wash it and then put the feathers and all the thing back on. And I called these pleasure commandos. And once again... She said, they don't know what you're talking about. They can't translate. That doesn't make any sense, because commando is so military and aggressive, and pleasure is when you're not under stress. And they said, they don't know how to translate. Think about combining those two. I mean, English is a fantastic language for creating these odd, you know, insinuations in language. And Japanese is not designed that way. It's relatively specific. I know that's a contradiction in terms, but it's relatively specific into sort of a field, and you can't violate that. Otherwise, they don't know what you're talking about, unless they know English.
this is actually the last question. So like looking at what was anticipated in the like atomic age and the space age and living through all of that, mm-hmm. do you ever feel disappointment that we didn't like get to flying cars or living in space or any of that?
I actually do, because we clipped the boisterousness of expectation, and that's very sad. And what happened was there's only so much money that a society has to work on. And the money went towards entitlements. It went towards social, get reelected assignments. And it didn't go to infrastructure. It didn't go, the R&D budgets in this country are fairly healthy, but they're not the percentage that they were back then. And so we're trying just as hard with less money. And so stuff isn't it's coming true at the outer edges of the technology balloon, which is miniaturization, memory condensation, compression, and things like that. But our bridges are falling down, and the cars look just like they did pretty much as in the 60s and 70s. They're smaller. I think a 19-foot-long car is about the right size. You know, 2.5 tons. I know. Gasoline in Europe is $7 a gallon. We don't know how lucky we are in this country that gasoline is back down under $3 a gallon. That's phenomenal. Remember when it was over $4?